Today I will be discussing on the interim treatment guidelines for Kerala state with regard to the COVID-19. So it was released just now. So this document is actually divided into five parts. The first one is with regard to the lab investigations to be done in case of proven COVID-19 patients. So basically these guidelines are all for proven cases of COVID-19 infection. Second will be about the categorization of patients into A, B and C. The third part will deal with the identification of high-risk patients. The fourth part will deal with the treatment strategies to be followed, and the fifth part with chemo prophylaxis. As you all know that we don't have as such a properly approved drug for treatment of COVID-19 anywhere in the world. So all the recommendations made in this guideline is based on the available evidence after referring the guidelines which are being followed across the world. So coming to the first part, so basically this is a living document, means that as the evidence emerges with regard to the treatment of COVID, this guideline also will get updated. So coming to the first part, so for proven cases of COVID-19 infections, what are the lab investigations to be done? So at the time of admission, the routine blood investigations will be enough, like your hemoglobin, TC, DC, ESR, platelet count, RFT, LFT, CRP, RBS and ECG if indicated. So CRP is very important because now it can be taken as a prognostic prognostic marker later on. So if clinically indicated, the patient should take an X-ray chest, means that X-ray chest need not be taken for all cases of proven COVID-19 infection. So if indicated, a portable X-ray need be taken. Then in case of transaminitis, the patient should undergo HBsAg, anti-HCV, HIV testing, and the severity markers like D-dimer, ferritin, LDH, CPK, etc. can be done. And if you are suspecting a bacterial superinfection as well, a blood culture and procalcitonin can also be drawn. So every 3 days, based on the clinical situation, the patient is clinically deteriorating. So all these investigations, especially the hemoglobin, TC, DC, platelet count, ESR, the creatinine, the LFT, CRP, LDH, CPK, ferritin, can be repeated. So in certain situations, HRCT, if the institution medical board feels that HRCT is indicated, that can also be taken. And in case of immunocompromised individuals with pneumonia, with COVID-19 positive pneumonia, we need to think about other opportunistic infections as well. Now coming to the most important aspect, that is the categorization of patients. So we know that for the testing as well as for admission, we are having this ABC criteria. So for the treatment aspect also, we are following the same criteria ABC, but with a slight difference. Here the A won't have fever. So you know that for testing the A has fever. Here the A is not having fever. It is basically mildly symptomatic individuals, that is a mild sore throat, a cough, rhinitis or diarrhea. So that is the category A patients. So the category A patients, we are advising only symptomatic treatment. Even if they are COVID-19 positive, if they belong to category A, the treatment will be supportive only. Now coming to the category B. Category B is actually fever plus cough, rhinitis, then sore throat, with or without diarrhea. Okay. And the second aspect of category B is more important. That is actually category A plus, the features of category A in patients with comorbidities. That is category B. But here, the most important aspect is that when you compare it with the category B in the testing criteria, in the treatment criteria, the category not to satisfy as category B, either you should have fever plus cough, sore throat, diarrhea, or category A plus two comorbidities. The comorbidities are lung disease, heart disease, liver disease, kidney disease, neurological disease, hypertension, hematological disorders, uncontrolled diabetes, cancer, HIV, patients on immunosuppressive drugs, on steroids, pregnant ladies aged more than 60 years. So the category A plus, you need to have two of these. Okay. Or category A plus a person having cardiovascular disease, because cardiovascular disease in studies have shown that the risk of progression to severe COVID-19 is pretty high. So even in a patient with cardiovascular disease, if they are having category A symptoms also, they merit treatment. It's very, very important. So category C is actually same as the category C in the testing criteria, that is those who are coming with the severe manifestations like dyspnea, hypotension, hemoptysis, cyanosis, etc. So the category C basically is the same as in the testing criteria. So here the basic difference is that category B is category A plus plus 2, that is it's not just diabetes or hypertension, they need to have two of the comorbidities, or it should be category A symptoms in a patient with cardiovascular disease. Now coming to the third part, that is the identification of high risk patients. So basically those with comorbidities like uncontrolled diabetes, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, lung disease, CKD, CLD, those on immunosuppressives, HIV, congenital immunodeficiency disorders, those above 60 years definitely are a high risk category. Now when you come to the clinical assessment, so the high risk the parameters are an SpO2 less than 93% on room air, tachycardia more than 125 beats per minute, respiratory rate more than 30 per minute, hypotension, that is a systolic BP less than 90 or a diastolic less than 60, the presence of altered sensorium. So these are the clinical parameters which will point towards a high risk outcome. So when we are looking at the lab values which points towards a bad prognosis, which includes the CRP more than 100, CPK which is twice that of the normal limit, a ferritin which is more than 300, a TROPT positive which gives a clue towards myocardial involvement, a LDH which is more than 245, a positive D-dimer, multiple organ dysfunction and absolute lymphocyte count. As you know, so in COVID-19 there is a progressive lymphocytopenia. So and neutrophilia. So absolute lymphocyte count less than 800 is actually a bad prognostic sign. Now coming to certain caveats as far as treatment is concerned, certain things you need to avoid. For example, you know that ibuprofen is associated with bad prognosis in COVID-19 disease. So you need to avoid using NSAIDs other than paracetamol while treating patients with COVID-19 infection. Then as far as possible, we need to avoid using nebulized drugs, and because this nebulization will lead to aerosolization of virus. So whenever possible, use MDIs, don't go for nebulization of drugs. And till proven, for all the symptomatic patients, till their COVID result is obtained, they have to be treated just like influenza. Okay, so ILI categorization will apply to all the symptomatic patients till COVID is diagnosed. Then in order to treat the secondary bacterial pneumonia, which is likely to occur by around 5th or 6th day in patients with COVID-19, the antibiotic selection should be as per the institutional antibiogram. Avoid using systemic steroids. This is actually very, very important, because studies have shown that the use of systemic steroids does not have any mortality benefit. It actually delays the viral clearance, but this also comes with a rider. So steroids may be considered in certain situations, like for example patients are in refractory shock, you can give the stress dose of steroids. In patients having a macrophage activation syndrome, also steroids are indicated. And patients with cytokine release syndrome, patients CRS is a cytokine release syndrome. So there is a gradation 1, 2, 3 and 4. In the cytokine release syndrome 3 and 4, steroids may be indicated and may be given as per the guidelines. Then if the patient is critically ill, as far as possible, you should try to avoid non-invasive ventilation, because non-invasive ventilation is associated with generation of aerosols. So healthcare workers may be at increased risk. So if the patient requires invasive ventilation, you should go for that at the earliest. Try to avoid using NIV. Then with regard to the use of inhaled steroids, suppose the patient is an asthmatic and has been on inhaled steroids, the studies have shown that the use of inhaled corticosteroids is that affects the local immunity and may lead to the decreased clearance of the virus of the SARS-CoV-2 virus from the upper respiratory tract. So the advice is to stop the inhaled corticosteroids, but it comes with a rider. Suppose you are stopping the corticosteroids and the patient may go into bronchospasm. In such situation, it has to be a risk versus benefit. So in such scenarios, the treating doctor can decide whether to continue the inhaled steroids or not. Now coming to the treatment strategies. The treatment strategies is as per the ABC, the division which was discussed previously. So in the category A patients, that is those patients who are having only a rhinitis, mild sore throat, cough, etc., without fever, in this category of patients, we are not advising any antiviral drugs. So they need to have just symptomatic treatment. This is very, very important. But then the most important thing is that every 24 to 48 hours, you need to have a relook at these patients to have a reclassification, whether to see whether they are progressing to category B or not. That is a very, very important aspect as far as the treatment of category A is concerned. So coming to category B, so category B definitely requires treatment. So the first line drugs that we are advising as per the current guideline is a combination of hydroxychloroquine with azithromycin. So hydroxychloroquine, the dose is say 400 milligram BD on day 1, followed by 200 milligram BD for the next 4 days. This is important. The dose is 400 milligram BD for the first day, followed by 200 milligram BD for the next 4 days. So if the hydroxychloroquine is not available, you can use chloroquine and the dose is given in the treatment guidelines. This is very, very important. So we would like to prefer HCQS upfront instead of chloroquine. But if in case chloroquine is not available, hydroxychloroquine is not available, you can use chloroquine. And the most important aspect here is that hydroxychloroquine, you need to know the contraindications for chloroquine as well as hydroxychloroquine. These drugs can lead to QT prolongation. So if the QTC is more than say 500 milliseconds, it is a contraindication to use of these drugs. And you should keep in mind that azithromycin can also lead to QT prolongation. So when you are combining this HCQS or chloroquine with azithromycin, so you need to have a close look at the QT. So QT monitoring, QTC monitoring is essential. So the other contraindications for the HCQS, apart from a QTC more than 500, are porphyria, myasthenia gravis, retinal pathology, epilepsy, etc. And the important thing is that pregnancy is not a contraindication. This is very, very important. And suppose, now coming to the role of lopinavir, ritonavir in the treatment of the category B patients. So lopinavir, ritonavir can be used in this situation only when the chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine are contraindicated. Now coming to the category C patients. So category C patients are those with the severity, the patients with dyspnea, the hypotension, all those stuff. So in this case also, the treatment regimen that the guidelines recommend is a combination of hydroxychloroquine with injectable azithromycin. That is IV azithromycin plus hydroxychloroquine. The dose of azithromycin is 500 milligram on day 1, followed by 250 milligram to be continued. In this scenario also, if hydroxychloroquine is not available, hydroxychloroquine can be replaced with chloroquine. Now coming to the role of lopinavir, ritonavir. So lopinavir, ritonavir can be used in the category C also when there is a contraindication to the use of chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine. And suppose the patient in category C patient is rapidly progressing into ARDS or MORDS while on a combination of HCQS plus azithromycin, you can consider the addition of lopinavir, ritonavir to this the HCQS. So HCQS or the chloroquine is the backbone to which we can add lopinavir, ritonavir in case the patient is rapidly progressing to ARDS or multi-organ dysfunction. So because in the such scenarios, almost all the guidelines do recommend the use of remdesivir, which unfortunately is not available in India. So you can consider combination of HCQS plus lopinavir, ritonavir after stopping azithromycin. So why you need to stop azithromycin is also important, because all three drugs can lead to a QTC prolongation. So it is better to combine HCQS plus lopinavir, ritonavir. But in such a scenario, you need to monitor your QTC very, very frequently. And as you know, as per the state policy, lopinavir, ritonavir has to be used on a compassionate ground. So the guidelines for the compassionate use of lopinavir, ritonavir is actually available as an attachment to this guideline. And also you need to take an informed consent when you are using lopinavir, ritonavir. It's very important. Now coming to the next aspect. So in majority of the cases of COVID-19 pneumonia, so can progress to, so the critically ill people, so maybe out of 100 patients, 15 can develop severe disease, of which around 3 to 5% become critically ill. So those who become critically ill, the critical illness is actually due to the cytokine storm or cytokine release syndrome. So there is a gradation, that is the Pennsylvania, the criteria is there for grading the cytokine release syndrome. So the grade 1 means, so this is a mild reaction, there is no need for IV fluids, there is only low grade fever, there is no treatment is indicated. Now coming to the grade 2 or the moderate reaction, here also here the fever is a high grade, so maybe around 103 degree Fahrenheit, and there is a requirement of IV fluids and mild oxygen requirements. There is a grade 2 acute kidney injury, and there and LFT is also deranged with the bilirubin elevated to say 2.5 gram percentage. In this case, so you need to send for CRP, because even though the international guidelines say it is, you need to send for interleukin 6, because interleukin 6 and interleukin 10 are pro-inflammatory cytokines, which are actually considered as the markers of the cytokine storm. So since IL-6 is not easily available here, so we can use CRP as a surrogate marker, and that is the reason why the initial investigation we need to have a look at the CRP. So because only then we can have a comparison between this value and the baseline value. So CRP can be used as a surrogate marker for IL-6 in this situation. Now in grade 2 reaction also, we are not advising any specific treatment. So if it is a grade 3 or a severe reaction, so this means that the patient is rapidly deteriorating, so the respiratory status is deteriorating, the radiographic infiltrates are expanding to involve almost the entire lung, the SpO2 is less than 93% in room air, or patient is on supplemental oxygen, say BiPAP, CPAP, etc. So there is a grade 4 liver dysfunction, elevated liver enzymes, bilirubin more than 2.5, INR which is more than 1.5, or the patient is in hepatic encephalopathy. So grade 3 acute kidney injury, the patient is requiring say IV fluids for resuscitation, patient is having a deranged PT, INR as well as APTT, that is the patient is progressing to DIC, and patient along with this IV fluids, so grade 2 reaction they required IV fluids, grade 3 reaction they, along with IV fluids they are requiring a low dose vasopressors, that is a NORAD 0.5 mics or adrenaline 0.3 mics. So this is the grade 3 reaction. So grade 3 reaction, how are you going to treat it? The patient is already on say a combination of say hydroxychloroquine plus azithromycin, and the patient is progressing to say grade 3 stage. So here the guidelines do recommend sending for an IL-6. So in our scenario it may not be possible, so we will send the surrogate marker CRP and compare with the baseline value. So if it is very much elevated, say with the associated elevation in lactate, ferritin, etc., so the recommendation is to add an IL-6 antagonist, that is tocilizumab, and the dosage of tocilizumab, etc., clearly mentioned in the document. So the use of tocilizumab has to be taken by the institutional medical board, because it's not a very very cheap drug. So it is advised only for a grade 3 or a grade 4 reaction. So the difference between a grade 3 and a grade 4 reaction is, so grade 4 reaction is along with this grade 3 there is a life threatening multi organ dysfunction, patient requires ventilation, and hypotension requiring high dose of vasopressor. So the patient is really terminally ill in grade 3 as well as a grade 4 reaction. So grade 4 reaction along with this the tocilizumab, you have to add consider corticosteroids. So in our scenario, so probably tocilizumab being an expensive drug, so it may not be easily available, etc. So these are two indications, the grade 3 as well as grade 4 reaction. So when tocilizumab is not available, is may be an indication for using a low dose of steroids. So when we say steroids, you know that the steroids, the indications in COVID-19 is a refractory septic shock, or a patient having macrophage activation syndrome, or a patient in grade 3 reaction where they can't afford tocilizumab, or a patient in grade 4 reaction where tocilizumab has not worked, and in these scenarios you can use the methylprednisolone. And the glucocorticoids should be used only for a very short period of time, that is for 3 to 5 days, and the recommended dosage of is actually methylprednisolone 1 to 2 milligrams per kilograms per day. So it may amount to say around 60 milligram BD, that is the maximum dose of methylprednisolone in grade 3 or a grade 4 reaction, and you need to give it for around 3 to 5 days. So because if you are using a larger dose of steroids, it's going to be a counterproductive thing, and it may delay the viral clearance, and because of its immunosuppressive effects, there is a chance of a secondary bacterial or a fungal infection. So, and there is an algorithm which clearly documents in the guideline, there is an algorithm which documents the treatment strategies to be adopted for this, the category A, B and C. And now coming to the chemo prophylaxis part, yesterday ICMR task force did give some recommendations regarding the use of hydroxychloroquine for chemo prophylaxis. And it's a bit of a controversial thing because it's not a very evidence-based document. But then the advisory is only for healthcare workers who are taking care of these COVID patients, suspected patients or a proven case of COVID-19. So advisory is only for these healthcare workers or for the close contacts of a proven case who happen to be household contacts. So in such situations, that is healthcare workers who are taking care of this COVID-19 suspects or a proven case, or the close household contacts of a proven case of COVID-19. These are the only two scenarios where ICMR recommends the chemoprophylaxis with HCQS. And the dosage for the healthcare workers are, so you need to take 800 milligrams in the first week and then 400 milligram every week for 7 weeks. It's very important, and the exclusion criteria, all those things are clearly given in the ICMR document. And in household contacts, who happens to be the contacts of proven cases of COVID-19, so they are supposed to take the same dose, that's 800 milligram in the week one, then 400 milligram in the coming weeks for a period of 3 weeks. So this is very, very important. And while using this hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin combination, the most important aspect is that you need to have a close look at the QT interval, because these both the drugs can lead to QT prolongation. Thank you very much.